One of my newest friends in Athens, a fellow compatriot introduced by Giovanni, is a man by the name of Paul Miller. Paul's a very interesting man because he has managed money for very important sovereign wealth funds. He is financing films. He's an entrepreneur. He knows a lot about the creative industries. He's agreed to speak this morning about a blend of financing film and so forth. Would you please welcome Paul Miller to the stage?
Thank you. Thanks, Julie. This is fun. I have to say it's been fun. I've never been to something like this before, but I realize that you're all very similar to being movie producers. And that, well, you know, yes, the numbers are important. What's really been impressing me is just people's ideas. You know, they see an opportunity in the market and they have a vision and an idea, and they obviously try and come up with a plan and raise money against it, which is exactly how the film business works. So as Julie said, I've been producing for around 25 years. I produced mainly in the US, but a lot in Europe and recently in the Middle East. And in addition to that, I have been privileged enough to run a couple of funds, one a sovereign wealth fund in Qatar, where we invested all over the world. I ran a private fund for some high net worth individuals in New York, and also ran a fund with one of the studios. So I've been making movies out there. Some of them you may have heard of. My model, I guess, essentially was making independent films, so sort of $5 to $15 million range with big movie stars. There was from about the 1990s till to today, there's a lot of money flowing out there and a lot of people interested in investing in the movie business. The third thing I occasionally do is I run a sort of bespoke event like this, but it's for high net worth individuals interested in the film business called the Investors Club. So I do one at the Cannes Film Festival, I've done one in Dubai, and I've done a couple in Saudi. And that's really about demystifying, which is a little bit what I'm going to do very quickly in 20 minutes, film investment, because I think there's a notion that, oh, I like that actor, or I like this director. I'm going to just write a check for whatever they want, and I'm going to hope that people go see the movie. And I think what I'd like to do is explain a little bit today how you can be a bit more clever about that, and you know, sort of protect your downside. And the final thing I do also is I do a lot of consulting for governments on policy and strategy. I work with the city of Athens at the moment. But I've also consulted with the Dutch government and others. So, yeah, I mean, what's interesting, I just showed these are some of the movies I've done, but I would say 50% of these were done with private equity, if not 100%. Men with Guns was financed by Paul Allen, and others by, you know, wealthy individuals or companies, and some of them are more studio movies. And I think I think everybody's heard, you know, the film industry's been going on for 100 years, and I put this up because I know you guys like this sort of stuff. This is from PwC, but it's, you know, it's anticipated to be a $2.9 trillion market by 2026. And you can see it has a decent compound annual growth rate. And this is all entertainment and media, it's not just movies. And, you know, as you probably know, the gaming industry is three times the size of the film business. And when I say film, I'm actually putting together television as well, especially for the rest of the talk, drama series that you see on Netflix and stuff like that, they're financed very, very, very similarly to movies, so it kind of applies for that. I think one of the things it's interesting to me is why do people invest in film? The next slide will be about the pluses and minuses on a financial side. But one of the things when I do these investor club things that I ask people around the room, I say, so why do you want to invest in film? And I would say only 20% of people are actually really concerned with making money. I think everybody's concerned with not losing money, but it's a very experiential investment. I mean, I had a guy who put in a couple million dollars into a movie. He flew down to set on his private jet. He said, what do you want? And I said, why do you bring 100 Haagen-Dazs bars? And this is in the southern jungles of Mexico. So he turned up with 100 Haagen-Dazs bars for the crew, and that was a great experience for him, and then we got nominated for a Golden Globe, and he went to the Golden Globes, you know. And he also he didn't make a lot of money, but for him, you know, he had a great experience, and he didn't lose money. And I always said I would never, when I work with investors, I always make sure that, you know, you can't guarantee things, but I say all the movies I financed We've never lost money. The investors never lost money. They may have made a lot of money, but they got, you know, sort of the intangible assets of the experience of being part of the film business. And, you know, the other three reasons for the love of cinema, you know, being in that world, a lot of people are interested in finding a new talent. And the last one is, you know, become more and more popular now, especially in documentaries, is to, you know, pick a subject that you care deeply about and make a film about it or make a documentary about it as a way to let people know, you know, what's going on about this issue that you care about. And it's, you know, as you know, there's films you've seen or documentaries you've seen that do have an impact not only with audiences at large, but also with decision makers. The Workers' Cup that I showed you is about migrant workers working in Qatar for the World Cup. You know, and the Emir of Qatar saw it, the Olympic Committee saw it, you know, the trade organization saw it. So it is part of that conversation. So here's some more sort of, for this audience, some more, you know, pragmatic reasons. One is, you know, for not much money, you can potentially make a lot of money. I mean, you probably all saw the movie Get Out. I mean, Get Out was made for $4.5 million, and at the box office alone, it made over $200 million. I made a movie, luckily, many years ago that was made for $5 million, and it grossed over $35 million. So, you know, it doesn't always happen, but it can, and that can be exciting. I think the other thing people forget is, of course, there's the box office. But there are many multiple revenue streams, you know, and you've probably also heard on sort of in Hollywood movies, they use, you know, there's toys, there's games, there's a 360 experience. But even so, there are multiple ways to get your money back. If you don't have a theatrical release, there's obviously the net, you know, the streaming, there's pay-per-view, you can sell in different territories, each country, each territory can value your film differently. Fairly short lockup period. You know, 86% of the revenue of a movie usually comes back within the first 2 years, and 98% within the first 3 years. So, you know, of course, that can also not happen, but generally speaking, and you'll see later, as a graph later on, sometimes if your movie is resold again, like I had one of the movies I did, Lone Star, it keeps reselling, so I keep getting money from it. So somebody buys license rights for 7 years, the 7 years expire, it's doing well, they buy it again. The last two, this obviously for investors, like in anything else, you can get an individual tax benefit in most territories. And more useful, I suppose, is a lot of countries have set up where bundles of taxpayers are put together and invest in cinema. I mean, the Belgians are famous for it. Louisiana has one like that. So if you live in a territory, the UK have one, where this is, you know, your accountant can advise you, but it's slightly better, I suppose, because it's very regulated. And the final one is, it's a bit like Jonas Anker yesterday. It's like music, you know, it's anti-cyclical, it's non-correlated. And famously, movies have done really well in the worst of times, you know, historically during world wars, during recessions, during COVID. You know, although people couldn't go to the cinema during COVID, of course, you know, Netflix did very well and all the streamers because people want to be entertained. And it's still a very cheap form of entertainment, like Spotify, like Jonas mentioned. You know, a Netflix subscription is the same. So one of the sort of interesting things is whether film is, I don't know who, I just ask, who here thinks film is art? Okay. And who thinks it's commerce? That's interesting. Okay, so these are the first investor audience, but it's true that it's always 50-50. And I find it interesting what people say. Of course, I think it's both. You know, there are films that are made for purely artistic reasons that may have some commercial value, and there are films that are made commercially that have some artistry in them. I mean, the Marvel movies have some artistry in them, I guess. But they're really made to make money and, you know, something like, or sell toys or sell games. But what's sort of fascinating about it is, especially since we're in Europe, that correlation between art and commerce has to do with the government, I mean, with the funding. By and large, commercial movies are made with market money. It's investors, they're looking for some form of ROI. Whereas if you see film as art, In Europe anyway, there's government subsidies. I mean, in the 1950s, after World War II, Hollywood was basically everywhere in Europe. And the European governments got together and thought, we have to save our culture, we have to save our cinematic culture. And they created this subsidy system, and you've maybe heard of MEDIA, which is the sort of pan-European fund. But each country has its own fund, and they support movies that, importantly, are usually in their local language, and that have some cultural relevance or historical value to that culture. It's why this notion of co-productions where the two countries get together often don't work, because something that's relative or relevant to France is not relevant to Germany. So there's this mix between the market and the subsidy. And just to give you, the government subsidies in Europe total $3.4 billion annually. So it's a lot of money. It employs a lot of people. Which is one of its raison d'etre, is it employs, I think, several million people. There are some issues with that in the terms of it keeps productions quite small, it keeps companies quite small, because the reason for it is not so much to make money. It's to get distribution, to spread, just like say that you might do for ballet or for opera or for theater. It's more about a cultural reason. And so they don't tend to sort of do so well in the market. I would say now in the last few years or last 10 years, that's become more of a mix. So people are mixing market and government money in order to deliver stuff that has cultural relevance, but also can do well commercially. Since I'm a producer, I thought I would, this is my favorite slide. Would anybody like to say where the producer sits in this slide? Yeah, the uncomfortable position of the tip of both points there. So, and I think it's quite nice because, I mean, a producer is a little bit like being a CEO. You have your responsibility to your fiduciary responsibility to your investors to deliver something that you said that you would deliver on time and on budget. On the other hand, you have to create an environment where you're working with a lot of creative people, where they can be, you enabled an environment where they can do their best work. And that's crucial to actually getting you your money back in a way. And a lot like, also like a CEO, you're responsible for building a team, coming up with an idea or co-opting an idea or being shown an idea that you think is great, coming up with a team, to do that, to follow out that idea, raising the money, and then controlling that spend to make sure you stay on budget, and then of course delivering that, and finally of course marketing and distribution. You have to know, it used to be called show business, and it still is. You still have to be able to sell your idea, and importantly, know who your audience might be. That may change a little bit, but essentially you need to know who you're making this for and scale that. If you're making a Marvel movie, obviously that's what's called hitting like the four quadrants of the audience, but maybe you're making something like a movie that's very specifically geared at, older, females, upper socioeconomic class. And then you make a film that is scalable to that. So, a bit like Jonas again talked about, this is the kind of essence of what the film business is. And it's about taking an idea, a piece of intellectual property, an IP, and it doesn't actually have any value. Okay, maybe if a script's written by somebody very famous, it has some value, but essentially a script has nothing. And the job of the producer is to increase the perceived, and this is important, perceived value of that piece of IP. So here's just a little, so you have your script, and how do you improve, increase the value of your script? You've probably heard this term packaging. So you put together, you get a director who's pretty good. You get some movie stars that are pretty good. Maybe you find some government subsidies. You get to something that becomes, it makes it more and more attractive. Again, it has no real value. It's important that it's only perceived value. One of the ways you sort of justify your perceived value is you work with what's called sales agents and distributors. Distributors buy your film for a certain country. So there's a Greek distributor or a US distributor. And you normally, if you're an American producer, you would go directly to your distributor in the US. For the rest of the world, you don't know all the distributors in all these other countries. So you use a sales agent to do that. They sell it to distributors in the different territories. The sales agent will look at your script, what sort of genre it is it a thriller, is it a comedy, is it an action movie? Look at the cast. Well, Liam Neeson's really popular here, but not so popular there. Great in Japan, terrible in Korea. The US thinks so much of it, and it'll give it a value. Now, at the same time, of course, you're working on your budget. You know, sort of, let's say you're making a $10 million movie. That's how much you think it's going to cost to make. And you want to see if you can get sales estimates that cover your budget. So you know that when you make the movie and you deliver a movie based on that script with those actors and with that director, that it should make that money. So there's, as I said, the value, the perceived value is given to the film. And then you as the producer go and raise money against that value. So the sales agent have told you if it does well, or you take the medium case scenario, it's worth 15 million. So then you have to go and raise, or 10 million, sorry, you have to go and raise $15 million against those perceived sales. You get the money from the financiers, all the paperwork's good, and you make your movie. You deliver the movie to the sales agent, to the distributor, and then just for the dynamics of it, normally they will then give you that money. Often at this point, the financing point, they're not gonna pay you till they get their product. So you have to borrow the money. You usually go to a bank or a private person who will loan money against these sales estimates. You make your movie, you deliver the film, and then you, at that point, and this is really important, at that point when you deliver the film and if your sales estimates are bigger than the cost of your movie, you're actually already in profit before it goes out. So it's really almost a business-to-business enterprise at this point. Then at that point, even here, there can be a return to the investors. If the sales estimates and the sale, and then when they, after they've made the estimates, they actually sell, so the film is done, it's with the sales agents, they value it, and they value the unsold territories as well, and they start selling them. This is before anybody's seen the movie. You can often see returns. Obviously, investors normally get a premium on their money. At this point, around here is where it's out in the public.
You made it red rather than green.
I know my friend who did it thought it looked nice and red, but it's true. It's exciting because it's red.
Yes.
Yeah. No, as I said, unless you have a screenplay by somebody who's really famous, they don't have any real value. I mean, they really don't. I mean, they cost anywhere from $50 to maybe $200,000 to have a, I mean, in the US it's $200,000 because of the Writers Guild, but I'm having something written now, it's 35,000 euros to write a script. He's quite a well-known writer, but it doesn't have any real value. If you have somebody like a Stephen Knight, who's a famous British writer, that has some value. You know, somebody might buy that off you, but not really.
We can do a sidebar, but will ChatGPT be writing scripts?
We can talk about that. Right?
Okay.
Yeah. So I think what I'm trying to is sort of impress upon you is that there's a way to invest in. I mean, I have a guy who runs Millennium Films. He made all these terrible Jean-Claude Van Damme movies. So he would go to Cannes with Jean-Claude Van Damme in front of a post, on a poster saying, The Monk. And he would pre-sell that for $10 million. He would then make the movie for $8 million. So he even knew before anybody'd seen the movie, he was in profit. Yeah.
So the pre-sale, so the agents are paying up front, so they're taking a risk.
They're promising to pay upon delivery. But yes, they are taking a risk.
Before it's sold one ticket.
Yeah. Because they know the value of Jean-Claude Van Damme in an action movie. And we'll talk about it later, but you don't, as a producer, you don't try and pre-sell the whole world because then there's no upside. You sell enough to cover your budget, and then you leave the unsold territories unsold, and then once the movie's made, it has more value. I mean, it's like buying a house on plans, you get a discount. If you buy a house when it's done, it's more. It's the same principle. So just to... This is really a rush through this, but anyway, there's basically two types of financing. There's collateral and equity. equity, you know about that. So collateral is there's two basic types of collateral. There's the pre-sales, which we've discussed. It's what people think the film's going to be worth. And there's a lot of what's called soft money. In Europe and the US, and actually all over the world, there are incentives for films to come and shoot. In Greece, it's a 40% production rebate. It means for every qualifying euro you spend in Greece, you get 40 cents back. It's very attractive. Cyprus is 48. Some of them are literally cash. You hand in your accounts, you prove that you have invoices with a Greek company or people with Greek tax IDs, and you just get sent the money later. Other ones are, as I mentioned, tax-based. They work the same, but the money is coming from tax people who owe tax. There are, and this is more in the US, but there's grants, especially for documentaries, there's sponsorship opportunities, there's in-kind services where somebody may do post-production on your film for free, and then say that, well, it costs, I don't know, $400,000, and apply that as if it's an equity investment. And then there are also these government funds, the government subsidies I talked about. And that's, again, these are cultural funds like the Greek Film Center. They have around a small amount, €4 million a year. And they give that, it's free, it's non-recoupable, to films that they think are good for Greece culture, you know, raise Greek awareness, awareness of Greece in the world, or talk about Greece history, Greek history. Obviously, the exciting sort of area in some way is the equity, because the collateral, like taking a mortgage for your house, you don't own anything. They're basically lending you the money, or rather maybe going back here. So these ones here you can borrow against, because they're paid after you deliver the movie. These are often, majority are paid after you deliver the movie. So you can go to a bank or a debt financing source and borrow money against that. But once they're paid back, they're out. They have nothing to say anymore. If invest as equity, of course, you have some ownership, you have some control of the IP, and then the tail, if the movie does well, the tail can be hopefully quite long. So just very sort of briefly here. So here are like the key elements of what I would call the value chain. So there's the ownership of the property, there's packaging it with bankable talent, which is a way of saying valuable talent. There's taking your film and looking at the international sales potential and distribution, selling off some of that, or pre-selling some of that, but not all of it. And then, as I said, using a combination of equity, debt, against this, and some soft money financing from local funds, that's basically how you finance a movie. So it's really not, I mean, you can write a check. Snow Angels, which was made, I mean, with Kate Becksinale, that was, somebody wrote a check. But normally it's done in this way, because then you're sort of mitigating the risk. Here are some safeguards that some of you may have heard of. There's obviously insurance is pretty standard. There's a thing called a completion bond. These are companies that look at your film and take a view on the script, the budget, the schedule, the director, and basically promise to you and to the investors that no matter what, the film will be delivered. So if things start to go badly, the bond can come in and give advice, and in worst case scenarios, basically take over the film. They can fire the director, the producer, and make sure that that financier gets the film that they paid for. I mean, I was financing a movie, an animation movie, it was a 3D animation film, and it started to go badly wrong. This is when I worked for one of the sovereign wealth funds, and I called in the bond company, and they made it a 2D movie, and fired the line producer, and they brought it in on target. You know, it's draconian, but it's a real, you know, it's like, as an investor, it's great, because you know no matter what happens, the movie that you signed up for and invested in is going to come back to you. And the other clever thing is a thing called a collection account manager, where, so you invest with a producer, and everything's great, and you think, well, who's going to make sure I get my money back? Because what happens if the producer runs off to Greece, or what happens if the producer drops dead? And the collection account manager basically takes all the money, all the revenue goes to this collection account manager, and they have all the contracts, and for every dollar that comes in, they pay out whoever's supposed to be paid out. And that includes the guilds and the unions, which is useful. So this is just a quick snapshot, but on the left is, you know, so this is for a $10 million movie. This might be a some soft money, some pre-sales, some equity against the unsold territories. Sometimes actors and producers defer some of their salary in order to keep the budget down. And this is the gap that's going to cover the unsold territories. And so the important thing, obviously, as you know, as an investor, is there's what percentage you're getting back, but also when you're getting it. And this is the sort of reverse of, and obviously the debt gets its back first. There's some interest. Sometimes you have what's called a corridor, so your actors get some first dollar money in, like Tom Cruise got, in fact, 25% on Mission Impossible, because he took a low salary. And then once the equity is recouped and has their premium, then traditionally the investors get 50% of anything that comes back, and then the rest of the 50% is split between the producers and some actors, and maybe sometimes some crew. And this is a sort of more sort of, I guess, more standard sort of recoupment, just to show you, here are all the different exploitation windows, and this flows down. You can see, I mean, a lot gets taken out. And so sometimes if you're just down here in the equity pool, it can seem a long way to getting your money back, which is why sometimes a combination of debt and equity is interesting. But it is, you know, and to some extent, some of these, you know, obviously if you sell straight to Netflix, you've just gotten rid of all that, if you sell straight to a streamer. I like this because this is another way of expressing it, where you see again the sort of the way it falls off. And this is also, the next one's actually probably more scary. So this is what happens if the film doesn't do so well. So you can see here that the equity investors never, well, they saw a little bit of money, but they never really, nobody did very well out of it. So it's important to sort of be clear-eyed about this. It was what I was trying to say at the very beginning, is that why are you doing this? What do you have to get? And that it can be a scary business in that respect. Here's another thing that I thought was useful, because a lot of this is sort of the time frame. These what are called windows are getting more and more compressed. It used to be we'd have a movie come out, wait 6 months before it was on, you know, DVD in those old days, another 6 months before it was on television, but these are becoming more and more compressed. And in fact, sometimes it all happens to what's called day-date release, so it all happens at exactly the same time. I mean, this is pretty self-explanatory. But you know, it's dribbled out so that each revenue stream is maximized. Here, and we talked about this at the very beginning. You know, when you make your money, this is from the British Film Institute. So I can presume these are pretty. It's kind of old, these ones, but it's the last ones they had. But you can see here, you know, they make money. This is 28 Days Later, which is a Danny Boyle movie. It did amazingly well, and then it went quiet for a while. And I imagine this is when there was a follow-up, like a remake, not a follow-up, but a sequel to this. And I imagine there was renewed interest. Here in King's Speech, it did really well. I think this is after the Oscars. It got another bump. And you can see, like, Girl with the Pearl Earring, again, did very, very well. I imagine it died down, and then either it was resold again, or Scarlett became Johansson, who's in that movie. She became a megastar, and again, people had more interest in it. So the tales can be, I mean, as I said, this movie Lone Star I made almost 30 years ago, and I still get, well, they're not that big, but I still get checks, you know, which is kind of amazing. When you're an investor and you're looking at an independently financed movie, these are some of the key, I would say, key elements that you need to kind of look for or you should expect. They kind of back into two sections. One is the creative elements, and I think almost the most important thing is the producer track record. I mean, it's like all the investments opportunities we heard in the last few days, like you really look at that person and go, yes, you're not really investing in the idea, you're investing in the person whose idea it is. And I think that's quite a fundamental difference, because you don't know, you know, generally speaking, you don't know much about movies, you don't know much about how the business works, but you trust the person who you're talking to, they know about it. They're gonna deliver the movie, not you. And so I think that's really, really, really important. You know, there's a synopsis, there's a script, who's attached, the director and the cast. Some sense of the director's vision is always good, you know. Also, like, what sort of genre it is. Is it a horror movie? Is it a romantic comedy? There's now often mood boards, which are visual images, and a sizzle reel. At the very end, I'm going to show you a sizzle reel for a show I'm doing. On the business side, these are all fairly standard, but you have obviously your budget and your schedule. You have your sales estimates. Often sales companies will be so enthused by your film, they will offer what's a minimum guarantee that they will pay up front. So let's say they estimate, they'll give estimates of high, medium, low. They might give you 80% of the low, of the takes, as an actual upfront money, or as a bank note that you can take to a bank and loan against. Those are the two ways they might do that. Movie comps are always very useful. This is like how other movies did that are similar to yours. That gives an investor some comfort. And I should say, you know, I would do this for private investors, but I also do it when I go to financing, film financing companies, who do the same exercise. This is key. Well, how are you going to get your money back? What's the recoupment plan? Where's everybody's position in? Who's out first? Who's out second? Can you optimize when your investor gets out? I mean, I have one film I'm doing now where I've suggested that rather put in equity, I'm having my investor put in debt against foreign sale, against the sales estimates. So she'll be out, you know, very quickly, and she'll make about her 20% return, which is nice. But that's that. There's no tail anymore. If the movie does really well, she's not going to be so happy, I guess. Sometimes it's nice to see proof, you know, that these people are really said, you know, the producer's really telling the truth. And so you can have what are called, well, LOIs, letters of interest from actors, from sales companies, who's really attached as cast, to give it some veracity. This is important, you know, what is the producer's plan for marketing and distributing the film? Maybe not all of these things are in place, and the equity is meant to be against the unsold territories. So it's a good idea for them to have some idea, well, is it a wide release? Is it a niche market? And this goes down to who is your core audience? Who am I really making this film for? Because your core audience is really crucial, because they almost become ambassadors for your film idea. And I just threw this here sort of at the end, but there are three typical ways to get involved. One is the three stages. There's development, film production, and what used to be called prints and advertising, which is now marketing. And these are hard and fast rules. These are just very general, like what one would call industry standards. So development's obviously high risk, because who knows if the thing's going to happen. The money's usually quite small, but it's why the return can be, you know, as much as 150%. And you get it back, this is important, you get it back if the movie goes into production. It doesn't matter how it does. Sometimes you can give them a first position to invest in the production, but they're out, you know, they've played their role, and they get some light of kicker, you know, at the end. Film production is obviously, it's much usually a larger volume. Again, this is a fairly standard, but no hard and fast rules. And again, as I said before, sometimes that can be a combination of debt and equity. As I said, one can negotiate any of these, but these are kind of the sort of, I would say, the industry standards. The other area to invest is at the distribution. A lot of films, I would say that a film's success is based, yes, on how good a film it is, but it's also how much money you spend marketing it. I mean, the Marvel movies are made for 75, 80, 100 million, but they spend twice that marketing them. The movie I made that did well many years ago, Lone Star, had a budget of $5 million. And the studio spent $7 million advertising it. So suddenly the recoupment position is not $5 million, but $12 million. And often the money back? Sorry?
Did they get the money back?
That one we got our money back. Three times over.
But in general, when you spend so much advertising, is it a linear return?
Yeah, it's pretty correlated, you know. And I think what I add this, because sometimes some of the smaller movies, you know, they're never going to get that sort of marketing. Oomph, nobody's going to put up that money. But a private investor can come in and say, hey, I'm going to put some money in to make sure this film really gets out there. And then they can recoup in a senior position. So, and you can also, as a producer, go to a company that's in marketing distribution or even a distributor and say, don't worry, I've got some money for marketing and distribution, advertising. So it's a way of boosting your film, and for an investor to get there, be sort of last in, first out, which is always or can be an attractive position. So just gonna, I'm almost sort of at the end here, but so one of the things you do is you wrap up all this in a nice brochure that looks sexy. This is a TV series I'm doing based on a book. It's set in the 1600s in Amsterdam at the formation of the stock exchange of the commodity markets, and in fact, capitalism and modernism. So it's a historical drama. It's about a couple who try and corner the coffee market, which has just been kind of brought in from the East. And I'll show you to finish off. This is a sizzle reel. It's a teaser. It's not accurate of the drama, but it's meant to give you a feeling of the movie. And the movie, although it's a period movie set 400 years ago, we want it to feel like now. We want it to feel like when they're talking about commodities and buying and selling and puts and options, it's like you're listening to it right now. So I think if I press this, it'll work. Yeah.
Valuable asset on Earth.
Four U.S. senators reportedly sold stock before the market's plunging.
Our reality has become increasingly shaped by false information.
People have got to know whether or not their president's a crook.
So the idea behind that is to show you're not going to watch like a very dark, serious drama, but it's going to have a lot of, it's a financial thriller about whether these, it's a Jewish Portuguese immigrant from the Inquisition and a very wealthy Dutch widow who, women had completely, put down at that time, and to a large extent, so were Jews. But in Amsterdam, which at that time was the center of the world, there was some freedom. And part of this also is to do with what's called the VOC, if you've heard of that, which is the very first multinational, the Dutch multinational that basically ruled the world, and there were 17 men who ran it. So we're also looking a little bit about multinationals, about the commodities, and about this notion that it was the first time in human history where you could work, you could earn money without really working, so to speak. And so this whole idea of that combined with, the existence of God, and this wrapped around this really hard, fast financial thriller, we think is an interesting idea.
Fantastic. Look forward to seeing it. You chose coffee.
When is it released?
Sorry?
Is it filmed
right now? No. I'm actually, it's being written right now.
You chose?
It's being written right now.
Paul, you chose
coffee as a subject over the tulips.
Well, it's based, the tulip fever. Coffee didn't have the same experience of tulip fever, which, as you may know, became this crazy thing that went really high and then went low. But no, it's also just based on a book that was called The Coffee Trader, and it's based on that. And I like, coffee as a commodity is interesting. It's also something that's ubiquitous, and it is, you know, people do drink. It is the drink of commerce, yeah. You know, and, you know, it was at that time, people were very scared of it. They were worried. It was very related, you know, it's a bit like cocaine. They're like, you've got really this energy. Right. I have a little log line there which says, you know, she drinks the coffee and she has this thing. You know, what is it? My feeling is desire. No, not desire, greed.
Very good. And then one other question. I really appreciate the presentation, extremely clear. Where does the advertising of a specific product, I'll give you an example, the transporter, the Expendables, they show the Panerai watch, mm-hmm. and they do it so deliberately. Do they pay an advertisement fee to the production company?
It's called product placement, and yeah, the producer literally goes, I mean, James, the Bond series are famous for that.
Omega.
I mean, a third of that thing is you know,
okay.
So that's product placement.
That's pre-income that can assuage an investor.
It would lower the cost of making the film. And you can treat it as income
right.
Post making the movie, or you can just say, I'm dropping the budget because we have, I don't know, half of our, you know, 10% of our budget is covered by product placement. I may with this do some work with some brands. I've talked to a brand consultant, and we're going to talk to Lavazza, Nespresso, nice. About... Because now advertising world, as you know, like it's all by association. So even though there's going to be no shots of Nespresso in this, you know, it's encouraging people. People, oh, I must have a cup of coffee, and that helps collectively the brand. And by association, hopefully, it's a good series. They might think, oh yeah, we put money in. I mean, Starbucks have their own entertainment division. They've only made two movies that I know of. But I think we will have some branding in this.
Very good.
Sales pitch. Is that your deck?
I used this to
raise money.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, I was using it the moment to really get a really good writer and to gauge the market a little bit because we're still writing it. So once we've written it, then we'll go out with what's called a Bible, which is a pilot script and all the episode breakdowns. And that then I have to raise. Then I need to raise money to actually make the series. It's a 6-part series. And I may at that point also go to some branding companies to say, now is the time you can jump on board.
Paul, I have a question, and it's about, isn't it in everybody's interest that as part of that micro economy to make a film, to have a share in the upside? Wouldn't it be better to have variable costs than fixed costs so that people could say, well, I'm only going to make 0.2% of the profit, but I'd rather take a lower base or no base and have a share of the upside so that you actively reduce the cost, not just drive the revenue, but reduce the cost because I have a share of the outcome.
I'm not sure I really understand the question, sorry.
So I'm Angelina Jolie and I'm $10 million a movie, mm-hmm. and instead of charging you $10 million, I'll say I'll waive my fee or I'll go for $1 million, but I want 5% of the movie. And then I have all sorts of incentives to help promote it, but which I'm contractually supposed to do anyway, but I do more. But the second thing is that I might decide not to take the limo to the shoot. I might take a taxi. I might decide not to stay at the 5-star hotel. I might stay at a friend's house in Athens when I shoot in Athens. There's all sorts of choices about how we spend money. If we have a share of the outcome, we choose to do the more reasonable thing. Not the cheap thing, but the more reasonable thing.
I'm for sure in the first part of that, yes. Of course, actors, that was what I, in that graph I showed, the deferred payments. Snow Angels, which was with Kate Becksinale and Sam Rockwell, they did not get their full fee at all. We gave them the minimum we could give them, which is a thing called Schedule F, which was, well, in this room I'll tell you, $65,000. But they had a quote, which was many hundreds of thousands of dollars. And so from the first, I think the first dollar in, they were 5% of that was going mm-hmm. to pay their salary mm-hmm. until it got to where it should have been. In terms of actually getting them part of the sort of producer role, yeah, that can also happen. I mean, Angelina Jolie is a good example of that because she's also a director. Mm-hmm. And I'm sure she didn't take a fee, and I'm sure she was mindful of those costs too. I mean, in the big scheme of things, hotels and all that stuff aren't really a big significant cost, mm-hmm. But the actor's fee sure is. And it's, as I said, the example I gave of Tom Cruise, I mean, that guy can probably get, you know, $30, $40 million a movie, but instead for Mission Impossible, he takes, maybe he takes barely anything, but he's taking 25 cents of every dollar that comes in.
Right.
So, of course, he's actually, it's a smart business move for him, too.
But the woman in the coffee trader, let's imagine she becomes, let's imagine she's an unknown actress, and she becomes a megastar. And they want to do everything from dolls to every type of merchandise. And if it's not in her contract, does she own the IP for things that have not even been envisaged at the time of the contract?
No, the contract for an actor will have all of that stuff in it so that she's giving all of her rights away, unless there's some specific thing. I mean, for example, when you option a book, which I did for The Coffee Trader, the author may say, well, you can have everything, but if I write another novel based on this, I get to keep that. If I do a podcast based on it, I get to keep that. So there are exclusions. Mm-hmm. But generally, for an actor, you basically, as a producer, get all rights for anything to do with the movie, even several layers of the onion out.
And new types of media in the future that we don't even know about.
Yeah, actually, one of the reasons, going to the writer's strike, is one of the reasons that everybody's so pissed off with the studios is that it used to be in contracts from way back when. It just said, you know, we own the rights for film, for TV, for video, da-da-da-da-da. But it didn't mention DVD. So when DVDs were invented, the studios just re-released everything on DVD, but they didn't share any of that revenue with anybody. Because they said, well, they were like, look to the contract. It says, well, where does it say DVD? Mm-hmm. So now all contracts say, in all media, in the universe, that exists now or is to be invented later. So,
Matt?
Great presentation, Paul. Really interesting stuff. Congratulations. I have one specific question and one general question. You said that on this waterfall slide that you can save the whole time until a potential investor gets money out if they just go to streaming directly. Is that one of the reasons why so many or increasing number of movies are coming out on Netflix and so on? That's my first question.
Well, it depends. I mean, it's exciting to sell your movie to Netflix because you get generally a good amount of money, but then that's it. That was it. You're never going to see another dime. So a lot of people prefer, well, let's see if we can exploit other windows first, like theatrical, and then let it go to Netflix. So yeah, it's a decision. I mean, it really depends on what you're being offered. You know, a lot of people also, and a lot of artists are like, well, my movie goes to Netflix, and I know people see it, but I don't have that experience of having a movie and seeing reviews and seeing it at the movie theater. And I mean, it's a little bit, you know, teary-eyed, but it's not a thing that to be sniffed at. I mean, now Netflix, of course, have this thing where they will do a theatrical release, maybe not a big one, but to satisfy that need, and of course, you know, qualify for the Academy Awards, etc. Okay.
And a specific question, really quick, on The Coffee Trader, looks very interesting. What would be, but just out of interest, because I actually have a client at the moment who's building a coffee brand in the Middle East, what would be a potential ticket size for product placement or sponsorship, just like a ballpark figure?
I mean, I think if they were going to be the only brand doing this, I think it would be quite significant. I mean, we're probably going to make each episode for $3 million. So I would look at something like $500,000 at least per episode. I mean, to me, it's a big brand opportunity. And I mean, and I learned this from one of the branding companies. What coffee as a whole is trying to do is break into China. They're trying to stop the Chinese drinking tea and switching to coffee. So there's a real opportunity there, you know.
Alex, please, and then Mamadou.
How do investors like us get involved in investing as equity partners in films like this?
Well, you know, one is to speak to people like me that you might know. I think everybody in there, I mean, you can go to film festivals, I guess, is one way. I mean, they do have a little bit like FDE, they do have opportunities where they, like by this investors club I do, you know, there's ways to get invited to these things if you're interested. How you find movies, it's a tricky one. I guess you can ask me to begin with.
I don't understand if it's a closed shop thing or is it?
It's less closed than it used to be. I mean, I would say that European producers generally rely very heavily on funds. They're not very familiar or comfortable with equity. The U.S., it's all equity. So there it's very accessible. And I would say that if you ever go to an event where there's filmmakers and put your hand up and say, oh, I have money, you know, you'd be very popular within about 1 minute.
But Paul, so, you were putting together a round, weren't you? Earlier this year, you were?
Yeah, I did one in Saudi earlier this year.
Okay, is it is Coffee Trader funded?
No. For Coffee Trader, I haven't gone to anybody at all for that one. I raised some money from a film production company in Netherlands to
so
I
no,
put I bought the rights. I put some money in, but I needed some more money to pay for the writer. So I joined forces with a Dutch producer.
Okay.
And that company put in money to pay the writer.
Okay. So nobody here who wanted to fund the Coffee Trader can fund it.
Sure they can.
Okay,
for sure.
That's his question.
There's nothing to fund at the moment because it's being written, but there's the next stage when, for sure, I'm more than happy to speak to people. So.
Perfect. I think that's...
I mean, one thing I'm saying is if you, as a producer, go in, the more you go to an ultimate financer with already in place, the more control you have.
You know,
the more you can say, this is how I want it to be done because I'm coming with some money.
I think that was the question, right?
Yeah.
Good. Yanni and then Mamadou. Yanni?
Two questions. Thanks very much, Paul. It was a great presentation. First one is, do you use any financial instruments or packaging to distribute to hedge risk across different films that you are or will make in the future?
Not really. I mean, the only sort of, I guess, instrument you would say is by looking at the perceived value of your film and to rely on that enough to raise money against it. You know, I guess that's the only, and we obviously often we get these notes saying we'll pay you when you deliver the movie, and so we go to banks or to financial institutions and say lend us the money until we deliver. And the third area is rebates, like in Greece. So you might make a movie for $5 million and have literally $2.5 million coming in, or it's supposed to come in once you finish the film, and you need that money to make your movie, so you again can loan against the production rebates,
right.
Like at 85%.
And a fun question, how much artistic involvement or pressure do you get from investors?
Ideally none, but it depends. I mean, I'm always like, you know, I'm happy to have a conversation about everything, but at the end of the day, I have to make the decision because I theoretically know what I'm doing. I know for Snow Angels, the investor we used, she wanted to invest in a movie. We gave her four choices, and she picked one that I thought was the most, probably the hardest to recoup on, but it's the one she wanted to do. And so we did that one. And it just recouped. It didn't do so well. You know, there are things like, you know, we were talking about it being non-cyclical and non-correlated. I mean, on a micro level, Prozac Nation, which I did, which had Chistina Ricci, Jessica Lange, Anne Heche, Michelle Williams, Jonathan Rhys-Meyers. It's a great cast, but it's about based on a famous book, oversold over a million copies. But it's about a middle-class woman who's having depression, and it is an important film. But we had our premiere on September 12th in Toronto, and nobody cared about middle-class Jewish girls from New York and their depression. So the movie didn't do so well. And at that time, actually, HBO had made a really preemptive offer on it to put it on HBO, which would have been a great home for it, because I think a movie about depression is something you probably arguably maybe want to see at home. But at that time, the agencies were like, we're not having our actresses go out on TV first. And they killed it, you know. Ironically, it was Jessica Lange's agent who did that. You know, now Jessica Lange did American Horror Story, and you know, was famous for that. So, times change. You know.
Yeah. So, you know, for just by way of background, my dad is a musician, right? Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of similarities in some ways. Mm-hmm. But what I've realized in the entertainment industry, if I may, is that it's still very skewed towards extracting value from the end customer. And by that I mean, in our case, our company is called Ubuntu. And it's a model where you don't actually, instead of extracting value from the customer, you get the customer to create the value. And what do I mean by that? And that's why we use, again, people are gonna laugh, but that's why we use decentralized technologies for. Have you considered basically an NFT model? Right, where you would have the script, so where the features of the NFT would be the script, the teaser like you have, and basically open it to a form of crowdfunding for that NFT to effectively fund it, right? And also because a lot of those films that I call alternative, not say, let's say not mainstream, mm-hmm. box office movies have an audience that is sufficiently aware and clearly frustrated too around a lot of mainstream content garbage, right? And that actual community, because the future is about communities, right? So I've been discussing that with one of my friends that I've been helping. What about nurturing those communities, right? Being able to identify them and have them to kind of co-participate versus just look at the high net worth individuals once again, to co-participate not only in the funding of the movie, but the money that you spend on advertising, right? What we're doing with the goal, for instance, is a referral model, right? Based on an NFT and on a wallet, where they become also your distribution and marketing agents along the way, so that the value that is created is aligned with that Ubuntu philosophy, which is ultimately I am because we are, where actually you create so much more by involving your actual audience.
Yeah, no, you're 100% right. And if we had more time, I would have gone on to talk about that. But that is the new wave of being very direct contact with your audience. And as you say, if you have you sort of groom your audience, they get to know you as a filmmaker, you're interactive with them, that's good for the film you're making then, but then it's even better for when you have another film that you want to go to.
Exactly,
and go, hey, guys, you're my ambassadors, let's get involved with this. And yeah, I mean, Kickstarter, there have been movies, funded completely on Kickstarter, but you're 100% right, especially for sort of niche. I mean, there's a filmmaker called Hal Hartley who was kind of big in the 90s, who made independent films, and he basically stopped making films that were theatrically released. He had his core audience. Woody Allen's a good example of that. Woody Allen made movies always for around 10 or 18 million, I think $10 million. Every movie was 10 million. And he just had Woody Allen movie 2008, Woody Allen movie 2009. And the people who raised money against that, Woody Allen had a built-in audience. There are people who, no matter what, every year went and saw a Woody Allen movie.
Exactly, yeah.
And you're somebody like, you could imagine somebody, like a well-known filmmaker, Spike Lee or something, like he has enough of an audience where he could do that himself, So certainly for emerging filmmakers and filmmakers in niche with niche audiences, I'll tell you one anecdotal thing. This was many years ago, before the internet, I was at some press junket going around, and I was sitting at this big table with the director and the other producers, and this guy sat next to me. And I said, "Oh, so what do you do?" He said, "Oh, I don't know what he said he did." He said, "Oh, I'm a filmmaker." "I said, well, what do you film?" He goes, "Oh, I film motocross, dirt bike competitions." I was like, "What?" He said, "Yeah, I go around the States and I film motocross events, and I put compilations together on VHS, and I put out ads in the back of motocross magazines, and I sell, like, you can buy the 1995 motocross." And I wasn't really interested. And I said, "Well, how much do you make doing that?" And he goes, "Yeah, $750,000 a year." I was like, "What?" I was just, but he was, my point being that he was doing what he liked, which is great. He had access, he knew his audience, and he knew how to reach them directly. He didn't take an ad on TV, he put it in the back of magazines, and people sent in a prepaid envelope, stamped envelope home. And I think,
yeah,
what you're saying is exactly that, and it's true that is happening a lot now, on a quite a small scale. But there's no reason why it can't grow up a bit.
Thank you.
Especially that the distribution is now dematerialized, right?
Yeah.
If the movie has an NFT, then once it's an NFT, then you can definitely have the identity of the person.
Yeah. There are a lot of people doing that at the moment, for sure.
We're going to continue at lunch that conversation.
Julie.
Who was the director behind Kill Bill and Pulp Fiction?
Quentin Tarantino.
And commercially viable?
Very.
Very, right? Like off the charts? What is he active?
Yeah. He just did Once Upon a Time in Hollywood.
Yep.
Yeah. So no, he's a hugely successful director.
Paul, thank you very much for sharing your vision.
Julie, you forgot.
Yeah. Tony, please go
gave
ahead.
Give him a mic and you forgot it. So I just wanted first to share, congratulations, Paul, on your presentation. It was an eye-opener. I want to share some, I believe it's important information, especially in your field. In 1932, there was a big lawsuit It was Princess Irina Yusupova versus MGM Metro. And that lawsuit was for misrepresentation of facts during the film that they have produced at that time. So that lawsuit was lost by MGM, and they paid a gazillion amount that people compared it to the cost of the Trans-Siberic Railway at the time. So following that lost lawsuit started this disclaimer that any similarity with persons or people is purely coincidental, blah, blah, blah. And this is how it all started. Oh. After that, they made three more films, several books and all. But we have the rights, but that's another discussion that we have one-to-one later.
All right, yeah.
Fascinating,
yeah,
no. Wow.
Actually, it's interesting, on Prozac Nation, that's based on a woman, Elizabeth Wurtzel, and we obviously got her in optioning her book and her life rights. And then, of course, the book is full of her family and friends. And what we did is we got the life rights to her mother and her father, but the friends, like, we kind of just amalgamated that because nobody could say, well, that's me. So we made up we sort of took the characters from the book and made composite characters, so we didn't have to clear everybody's rights, because a person only has one mother and one father. They have many friends. Right. So, yeah.
Interesting.
Now, the reason I bring it up, because my wife is the great-granddaughter of Felix Yusupov and Yusupova, so we're really into that thing.
Wow. Listen, Paul, thank you so much for sharing.
Thanks.
That. It was fascinating. Absolutely amazing. Really
thank
interesting.
You.
Thank you. Thank you very much.